Just to help us with the recap from last week. We did something powerful last week.
Yeah.
Because we were already holding the picture of the message to his word. During the interval of some of the times in the office. I see you're not doing this in good conscience. Praise God. Anybody, so anybody will try to remind us. Anybody would like to give us a recap?
We spoke about conscience. And before the message properly started, we were taught about the four different types of conscience. We have the seared conscience, the lying conscience, the weak conscience, and then we also have the good conscience, which was mostly spoken about. And one thing I took from last week's service or teaching was the fact that just because you are doing something good doesn't mean it's coming from the right place. And having a good conscience is not, like, not having a good conscience is a very bad thing, but having a good conscience doesn't make you extraordinary. It's just like the analogy that was given to us was like when you go to work and you are paid for the services, there's nothing special about it, you just render it. But when you, after working for a long time and you don't get paid, then there is a problem. So it's also, and another thing I picked up from was that we shouldn't follow our hearts, because the other analogy that was used is like a wheelbarrow. Because as much as we believe we are following our hearts, it's just us still leading ourselves, so we should trust God.
Any other person? Yes.
One of the things that I got in that personal devotion is that having a good conscience is very key to following God's leading for your life, in that it gives you more fortitude. Because if you are, does having a good conscience delete every possibility of justifying the storm based on you? What I mean is that, like, if, let's say, for example, Joseph, right? Let's say that he had given into, at some point, into Potiphar's wife's temptation. Then he went to prison. He wouldn't have, he is actually, that being in prison was part of God's plan, as you see the timeline. But if he didn't stand right before God, he couldn't have that moral fortitude to know that, yes, I'm in God's plan right now, and I have to be, like, he was the leader among the prisoners. He was even, that is why he had the opportunity to access, and interpret the dreams of those guys, and later they came and said, oh, this is very bad. So maybe tomorrow you are going through a huge storm, and if you have a good conscience, like, maybe it's because I did this, maybe because, you know, you don't have that peace, but if you're in good standing and you have that moral fortitude, you can withstand the storm knowing and trusting God.
Yeah, because not having it puts a sense of doubt around you, and you begin to doubt why things are going wrong with you, why you start thinking maybe it's because of something that I did in the past, that is why my past is haunting me, praise God, or the people from my village that decided to have my town, you know, those things that are beginning to put you in doubt. Hallelujah. Good conscience. Any other person have something they caught from that? Any other person? Good conscience from last week? We can fire up. Some people still trying to ruminate. Praise God. Okay, yeah. Actually, good conscience is quite very important. Just like the Bible says, the Lord tries the heart. He tries the reins. He measures the. He knows the thoughts and intents of the heart, basically. And it's not just about doing what is right. It's about also the motive of doing what you think is right. Praise God. The motive, what is behind it. And in actual sense, is where would we run to hide from God? You know, there are some things we need to really check out. You know, some things we think, oh, I didn't do, nobody saw me. But the truth is, well, even the psalmist says, where will I hide from God? Even if I'm in hell, he sees me. To which ends of the earth would you walk? And what I'm trying to say is, it's not as much as what you did physically in front of people. It's as much as what was the motive inside. Praise God. Do you remember when Brother was talking about him getting the job? He thank God that he used good conscience and that praise God. And that he was able to tell the truth from the onset. Hallelujah. But in actual sense, good conscience is necessary. Your motive. Actually, it's something that is strong. With God, your motive is more important than the action that you carry.
What was the reason behind doing what you do? Because there are many people who will do something great, yet the motive is wrong. And before God, he weighs nothing. The world will celebrate it, awards will be given. In fact, people will hail. But before God, he has sifted it and he has realized that the reason you did it was totally wrong. Hallelujah. And somehow, when I saw, you know the story of Herod, right? When he sat there, and then the Bible says the people hailed him, and as he has spoken like what? Like an Arab. Yeah, he must have spoken like an Arab who's quiet. Everybody hailed him. But there was a problem. His motive at that point was wrong. And he refused to give glory to God. And what happened almost immediately? Worms, everyone consumed him right there. Praise God. But that's not our portion. Hallelujah. And it's the same thing with Nebuchadnezzar. When he got to a point in his heart, he felt, you could see there was difference. Yet, the truth I kept saying is, all the nations he conquered, truly he conquered, truly he became one of the greatest kings. But the heart was wrong. And then God had to teach him a lesson.
But today, Jesus Christ has died, and we are not seeing instant, what do you call this? Instant judgment and instant lessons. Praise God. So a lot of people are getting away with it. And Jesus gave us a very clear answer to that. When he said, what's going on? He says, leave the wheat and leave the wheat. Let them all grow together. The truth is, everyone will all grow together. He said, for that day, there will be a division. He will set them apart. That's when you actually know who was doing things for the right thing. Praise God. I was blessed by that. And then, yeah. So we are continuing in this talk of following us. I will get to the place that we touched on yesterday, so we are still going to go further in that. Hallelujah. As you follow God's plan, God's master plan is what? That every man we want be saved. And that we have agreed that in God's master plan, you have a role to play, right? And then we have talked about how you continue to follow God, hearing his voice, through the word, dreams, visions. We've talked about all this. And then we also talked about sometimes doing the next thing is what is right? Taking the next step after you got the example, after you finish your BSc in Nigeria, the next thing is to go and serve. Perhaps, usually, it is the next step God wants you to take. He's not giving you some major step that will jump from heaven and say, then jump to the next time. Hallelujah. So we've seen all this. Now, my question is now, as you're thinking that you're in your mind, where does your giftings and your talents, where do they come to play in God's plan for your life? The reason it needs to be put out there is because so many people believe that whatever is my talent automatically means that is God's calling for me. Praise God. And it has confused so many people, especially people who are multi-talented. Now, if it is easy for you who has maybe one talent to say, because I am talented in this, this is where God has called me to. Try meet those people who are multi-talented, they are very confused because they can do everything. So when they are talented in many things, what now happens? Does that mean they are called to many things? Praise God. What they end up, if you have to follow that, you end up becoming what they call jack of all trades, a master of them. But then what are talents and what are gifts in God? Praise God. These are things we need to establish so that you know that you are not just following, like they say, you are not following the wheelbarrow. But rather, you are leading the wheelbarrow. You are leading from here, you are pushing the wheelbarrow, right? But you are not just following whatever it is saying to you. Praise God. So where does our giftings, or what are talents and what are gifts, how do they play for a believer? Hallelujah. In Romans chapter 12, let's start from there. Romans chapter 12. I think I read some part yesterday. From verse 6, I'm reading from the NLT version. For those of you, if you can put that on the screen, he said, in verse 6, in his grace, God has given us different gifts for what? For doing certain things well. Please notice this, very well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. Next one, if your gift is serving others, please. If you have your pen or if you have something, keep noting these different giftings. Hallelujah. And as I'm saying them, reflect in your heart. We'll get there, but I just want you to get some things.
He says, I believe you speak out as much as you have in faith. If your gift is serving others, actually the gift of serving others is another word for, what do they call it? Serving others. Ministry. I mean, the real word is ministry. So for those of you who feel like when they call you a minister, you think you are the minister, that in actual sense, ministering is to serve, to wait on people, to attend to them. Praise God. So he says, the gift of serving others, serve them well. If you are a teacher, what should you do? Teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraged. If it is giving, give what? Generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take your responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it what? Gladly. Praise God. Note that part in your Bible. Now let's move to 1 Corinthians 12 also. We'll see another set of gifts that Paul tried to mention here. Notice it's the same writer and he's writing to different churches here. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He says in verse 7, but I would like to start something. He said there are different kinds of gifts. That's in verse 4. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts. Now notice, I think we've done the spiritual gifts here before. Why I said the thing is not actually spiritual gifts, it is what? It was spiritual. I'm talking about, but in terms of gift, now we call it endowment or manifestations of the Spirit. Praise God. And it's a gift by grace. Not that you earned it and not that you merited it. I don't want to go into details here until after I've read this thing. So there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. Notice one, the Spirit of God is the source of these gifts or these endowments. Says there are different kinds of service, but we serve the same God. God works in different ways, but it is the same God who does work in all of us. A spiritual gift is given to each of us. Please underline 7 also. The reason the gift is given is so we can what? Help each other. Another version says, for every man to profit without. So now, we are saying now, one of the reasons you have your gift is not for you. Actually, the primary reason you have your gift is not for you. Or you have any endowment of the Holy Spirit is not for you. It has never been for you and it will not be for you. Praise God. It is for the benefit of others. Remember the commandment of Jesus when he says what's the highest commandment? He says what? Love God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your mind and everything is in you. And then the second is like what? Unto it. Love your neighbor as your what? As yourself. So the primary purpose of you having a gift or being endowed by the Holy Spirit is not for your profiting, but for the benefit of the common man, of the one around you. Praise God. So he says, so we can help each other. So it aids to each one, each person, the Spirit gives the ability to give what? Wise advice. Please be noticing, there are some certain gifts mentioned in Romans 12. It's not all of them that are mentioned there, but there are some that he did not mention in Romans 12, is mentioning here. Because he has 12. So he says, to one person he gives ability to give wise advice. To another, the same Spirit gives a message of what? Special knowledge. For those of you who are far back on our scripture, please go and watch the YouTube video. We did a teaching on spiritual gift, so you can get the differences. He says, give a message of special knowledge, rather. Verse 9, the same Spirit gives what? Great faith to another. And to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. He gives one person the power to perform miracles, another the ability to prophesy. He gives one else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still another person is given the ability to speak in unknown languages or unknown tongues, like we said. And while another is given the ability to interpret the tongues. Now in verse 11, it is the one and only Spirit who distributes what? All these gifts. Hallelujah. Now, put that aside. So we go for Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. This is another part where Paul was trying to mention giftings in the church. Now he says again, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. The apostles, the prophets, the what? The evangelists. I wish I had a PowerPoint presentation. I would have been able to put many of these things together. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers. In 1 Corinthians 12, I think from verse 27, he also mentioned, he said, he has set some in church. Firstly, apostles. Secondly, prophets. Then he went on to pastors. Now, he didn't mention a lot of stuff, but as we're putting 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, Ephesians 4, we see that there are certain endowments that God has placed in the body of Christ. But notice, we have said before that one of the primary reasons for the gifts of God or the gifts of the Spirit in the body of Christ is for what? Edification. Building up the what? The local church. So in actual sense, within the church, there are gifts that is originating from God Himself. It means this gift have their source in God and will not be operational in you if you were not in Him. This particular gift. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Within the body of Christ. They are activated, or you are, how should I say, you are welcomed into this gift at your point of being what? Born again. Because they have their source where? In the Spirit of God. So He gives these different giftings within the body of Christ. And all their job is to ensure that what? You are edified. Or each member in the body is edified or built up. It is not for your profit, it is for the what? The profit of everyone with you. Praise God. So now within the church, we have people who are graced differently. Hallelujah. And this is solely in the book of 1 Corinthians 12. It says it is the Spirit that chooses how He wants to manifest. So He chooses whatever He wants to manifest through you. So now I get to understand that. Although when you read through, they say, since the gifts that Paul listed in Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, and Ephesians chapter 4, they were not, some of them he didn't mention, it is, please put this in quotes, it is perhaps that there are more giftings than what he listed, because since the list of gifts vary, praise God, but it is best that we operate with what we've already been revealed to, praise God, the one that has already been revealed to us in the Word of God. Now we see Paul is explaining these different giftings that there are different people in church with different graces. In Romans he calls it, each one has been dealt with according to the measure of faith. Praise God. It means within Christ there are some certain things He has distributed to everybody in the church. If you read from 23 downwards, he started talking about how there is an eye, there is an ear, there is a leg, there is the arm, there is this. It means the day you got born again, you took on a part of the body. Praise God. There is a part of the body that you have and that you are graced with. And that's why I like Romans 12 more, which says that some people are good at encouraging us within the church. Praise God. Some people are good at serving others. When he says some people are good at having mercy, what does he mean? You know, there are people who just can attend to the sick. You know, when people are sick or people are hurt, they can basically do, they just like to stay with them. And who's going to stay with sister? Oh, sorry, not you. Praise God. Who is going to stay with this person? Is there just stay? Let's cook for her. They just have this thing. Some are not patients. Praise God. Once they come and they need to, hope you're feeling fine. We pray for you. And then we'll go. It's not that they are wicked. But they just don't have that. I will enter it. But some people are grace. Melissa, the way you are looking, your eyes are swollen. I'm going to buy Lucozid. Praise God. I never thought Lucozid was just a normal refreshing drink, because they made us believe that only sick people take Lucozid. So I never buy Lucozid. For those of you Nigerians who grew up in Nigeria, you only buy Lucozid when you're sick. Praise God. But there are people like that. They just see you and they can quickly notice that something is wrong. Oh, who has been looking for you? That's the question we ask. Hey, yeah, okay, I'm coming tomorrow. Praise God. They have this and they are good at it. Hallelujah. And God knows. I pray we have people like that here. Praise God. I'll stand noticing myself. Praise God. But the Bible says that there are different people with different gifts. Some people can give generously. Bible advises us to give away. Hallelujah. But there are some people that can give their eyes.
Glory.
I mean, they can give generously. Right there and then, if you notice that you are hungry, okay, you see, it's only 50 tier that's left. Take this 25. No, I'll be fine. Are you sure? Are you sure? Is it like you want to take it? Are you sure? Praise God. Thank you very much. Hallelujah.
And there are people who give generously.
It's just so sad that people like that sometimes are taking advantage of
by brethren,
glory to God. But we tell them that if you are here, you are getting born again, and you are saved, and you will not take advantage of people.
But there are people who give them. And there are those who have the leadership ability within the body of Christ. Scripture says they should do it well, responsibly and diligently. So now, one thing I want to point out here is the fact that the giftings or the endowments within the body of Christ are graceful in the sense of you never work to earn it. You never merited it. It came by free grace.
How would I call it? Praise God. Words are filling my mouth this morning.
But it just comes naturally from God, not to you. Not because you worked for it, but because He desired to give it to you. So there is no time when you will start and say, the reason I have this thing is because of this. Praise God. You have a source in Christ. And it's only operational in you as much when you get born again. Now look at the gift of prophecy. Now, you some of you might say, out of people today with a professor, prophecies are different. Praise God. Because in actual sense of prophecy, it is an accurate revelation of who? Of Christ Jesus. It has nothing to do with anything outside. So when you say, out of the people of the devil, they have, notice something, the devil never creates anything. Please notice. The devil never has no capacity to create anything, but he perverses things. Do you know what I mean? Something is used for this, he changes it or he perverses it, but he never creates anything. So there is nothing he ever created in this world. All creation is from God. Do you get what I'm trying to say? So now, even if it is the gift of prophecy, or the word of knowledge, or the ability to teach, it is an endowment from God himself. And there are those that you can check yourself, ever since you got born again, there are some giftings that begin to work naturally in you, ever since you became born again. Perhaps you've not been paying attention. Praise God, they are there. Because every believer, at least will have one gift or endowment of the Holy Spirit. Every believer. You are not left out. Hallelujah. And most people speak in tongues, which is already, how would I call it, qualified for me at least. But most every believer has at least one gift of the Holy Spirit that is left out. Some don't pay attention, so they don't grow in it. Hallelujah. So you never paid for it. Those who go to school to learn how to prophesy, I doubt it. I'm wondering which God originates that. Because you don't learn to prophesy. You don't. There is no gimmick to it. You don't know what I'm trying to say? There is no gimmick to it. There is none. Say, come. Victor, come. I'll teach you how to prophesy. Do you teach people how to prophesy? You know, the Bible, John says, there is nothing a man receives except it as the word. I mean, give him. So who are you to say, well, you should not teach people to prophesy? He's just like saying, I want to teach you how to heal. We heal in the name of Jesus Christ. Praise God. The manifestation is of Him. I will teach you how to walk miracle. No, you will go and press sand. Maybe they call it a fat head. You will press sand. You will hold rosary. And you will do unnecessary things. Praise God. Because it is not in God. Or you will light candle and use holy water. Praise God. When you try to start learning things that are gifted of God, because it is for Him. I remember when young Peter said, I have the Holy Spirit, and He can choose to manifest all gifts of the Spirit that He wants, because I have the Holy Spirit inside of me. So the giftings of God, or the endowments of God, are originating from God as the source. And notice this, the reason you have those giftings is for the benefit of the next person. Praise God. It is not for you to profit. I'll still mention some things. Now, what then is silent? But before that, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. If you still have your Bible, 1 Peter chapter 4, that was another person who talked about gifts within the church. Verse 10, it says, God has given each of you a gift from His great variety of spiritual gifts. Hallelujah. What did He say? Use them well. For which purpose? To serve one another. Verse 11, do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God Himself were speaking through you.
Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory about you forever and ever. Amen. Notice something. Whatever it is that you do, do it as though you're relying on God, because He's the only one who is the source. And use it well to serve one another. Praise God. So now I've explained that giftings originate from the Spirit of God and are open to those who are believers. You work in the gift of working miracles. Some of you have never, ever since you got born again, that's when an unusual faith just wakes up in you. You just have this unusual reliance on God. You just trust Him. It just begins. You see, you don't know why it happens. I can't explain it. Hallelujah. If I somebody says, when I'm sitting at home, everything is fine, but the moment I just pick up the mic to speak, or the moment I start speaking, it's as if something takes over my mouth. It's as if something takes over me. I just begin to talk. Because by the time I'm gone, I realize it was me. I remember Andy was sharing, he said, sometimes I'm in the midst of preaching, and then I say a choir. He said, the moment the choir comes on the crowd, from that moment, I lose sense of what I'm saying. But I keep speaking. People are hearing me, but I don't know what I'm saying anymore. It's as if something takes control of my mouth. There was a time he says, I don't know how I got to the back. When the crowd came, I was in front, but by the time I came back to my senses, I was already at the back of the congregation. I don't know what happened. And sometimes under the crowd, I just walk and I'm laying hands on people. People are falling under the Holy Ghost and people are getting healed. I have no idea what's going on. But after I come back to my senses, then I realize that, a lot of things have happened. And that's to understand that that is God walking or manifesting through a man. Imagine Him coming up and saying, wow, I did that because I was this. Praise God. So now, what then are talents? What then are your talents? Because we tend to confuse these two people. Notice, before I go there, what then are talents? Talents are natural abilities that come to you usually as a result of genetics. Usually. You find that in a family where the father and mother maybe the same thing continues, there's a 99.9% chance that the children that they give birth to will have some form of inclination to singing. Or if you are from a family of orators, your father is an orator, your mother is an orator, and this like that, there's every chance that the child will pick up such genetics. You find situations where people say, I'm the only one that didn't have that. Every of my younger brother, they have the same. Talents are natural. And notice this, whether believer or unbeliever, they all have. But notice that God is the one who created everyone. So He's still the source. I get what I'm trying to say. But talents are open to everyone, whether believers or unbelievers. They are just your natural ability. Some people are just born. I like using singing. You just hear them sing from the bathroom like this, and then you are gone. You know, we used to watch high school movies. They used to tell us that song is the only way to bring boy and girl together. It's a magical song. So you'd be walking past, you'd be waiting for one of that your dream girl to be singing in the house. And then you now stop and then be like, I heard your voice as I was walking past. You are sent to me from heaven. But anyways, some people are naturally gifted that way. Some are good at calculation. They have a brain to handle calculation. Ever since, I remember I taught a boy in primary 6, that boy, his mother had given up on him because he had failed common entrance like 4 or 5 times. So his mother, they are beating him up. I'm telling you, if you tell him spell Victor, as a primary 6, you write XDVU. I'm telling you, I'm not joking. That was how bad he was. And he was going to write common entrance. So they sent him to me because I said I used to do home tutorial, and then the woman said, this boy is your project. If you can transform his life, God will bless you. Hallelujah. Or she paid me, but it's not just God will bless you. But then the boy came. Even when I saw him, I realized that there is a problem. Because when you, I don't want to, because this thing is recorded, so I don't want to mention his name. That was it. If you say spell the boy, he will write XD something. It never made sense for him. So we started. Do you know what we started from? Brighter grammar. For those of you who know better grammar, and Queen, is it Queen Grammar? I go up, am I to go up, is he to go up? I started with that, with him, to start. But I prayed, bro. Glory to God. I was praying in tongues, I'll be mentioning his name and I'll be teaching him. But something that he has. So I've given Come entrance. Anybody remembers Ugosiugo? Ugosiugo, that is the book to study. Ugosiugo, we solved every quantitative and math problem in the whole of Ugosiugo. We did everything. But there was something striking that I caught. Anytime I give him math to do, he will solve and get the answer. But he will not use, you know, we have formula that we use. He will tell you, you must use this formula. But he will use that formula. He will solve it and get it. And the answer will be right. Now, how did you get the answer? I said, I just did this. So ask him, how is it possible? You're not using formula. I said, but sir, we don't have to use this formula. What if we go this way? See, from there, I realized that this dude has a strong inclination for calculation. And nobody's seen that. That means he has a talent built in that he's not born with. Hallelujah. He's just a normal guy, but I started seeing that, and I told the parents, I said, this boy, bless God, he has 75% in coma entrance. Hallelujah. We will take some glory, go and take some glory. Hallelujah. But the truth is, I realized that he was just better. And I told him, watch this guy. He will be the next Einstein. We don't know. Because how is he able to beat the formula that I've been reading, and then he will go and find? And he's a young boy, so how did you think about that? It means somehow he's inclined towards calculation. So these are talents. People have different talents. Some people, all they need to hear is beat. When they hear the beat, they will drum it. Hallelujah. Others just play it or play every song they get the notes. And just keep checking that area. So you can tell that you have talent in your life. I'm sure you do that. But they are natural to you as a result of genetics. Or just inborn inside of you. Praise God. But the thing about talent is, as you keep, you need to discover it yourself. And when you discover it, you need to continue to learn and grow in that. For somebody who has a talent for calculation, for instance, and he's not taking 20 years when he learned mathematics, or he's not taught algebra, or taught anything, he will just remain like that. And he's on the spot. So talents are open to everyone. That's why you realize, that's why I keep saying something. If it is by that, people say Bill Gates has fulfilled God's purpose. No! Because everybody's, because somebody has asked that question to me before. If you are saying that God is not with this person, or this person is not, how come this person is making it and he's not born again? Come on! Praise God! Or how come this musician is doing well, he doesn't need God, and he's doing so well? No, he's his talent. And he's doing well in it. And the same thing as you, but that is not what leads you as a believer. But I realize that most times when you get born again, when God comes you to a particular position, he endows you with gifts that are related to that or that will help you in that area. Praise God. Now imagine if God had called you to teach, and you naturally have a talent in teaching. Now, you know what comes together now? Or God has graced you rather in the field, in the body of believer, to teach, and you have a natural talent to teach. What happens? It's like grace and, how will I call it? Grace and natural whatever comes together. You'll be teaching unusually. You know what I mean, unusually? Other people will go to learn to teach. It's just like what Bartholomew said. You will say it, but you'll not say it the way I'm saying it. Because what I have is what? Is mine. What you have is yours. But when I go into it, because I'm not just operating naturally now, I'm operating divinely. Praise God. So you must understand the difference. So you don't follow it. Talents are natural to you. They are. And you can check them. And they are good. No, they are nice. If you're good at playing football, doesn't mean God has called you to play football. But you might be good at it. I always say, I am short 20, you call me to play on your team. I mean, your whole team will just lose. When your whole team will lose. I will never forget I was going to play to an empty post. Empty post. Empty post. And it's on key post. You know, those of you who play multiple posts, you know you can't like this. That was about 10. 10 feet. Let me say, yeah, 10 feet. You can't tell like that. And they said, penalty. No, penalty with monkey post is empty post. So the keeper is there. He went like this. But that's the truth. That's how useless I am on the ball. And just as Antobi mentioned yesterday, I was one of those who were jealous, so I just said that's useless. Because I remember one friend asked me, what sport do you actually do?
in your life. Have you even placed one? Because when I knew you, I said, okay, I play basketball. Even in basketball.
Even when we go to Magen Park here, I make sure there's only these young guys that are around. I will bounce, we go, we do this. I okay, which has stayed with me on basketball before. Praise God. I bounce, but when pro start coming, I just said, no, it's me that brought the ball. I kid you anyway. I went to buy night sneakers. You think I'm a professional person. But when they come, I'm not sure I carry the ball. Because I don't want to embarrass myself. And I was like that. Never knew, but I knew where I was good at. Praise God. I knew where I was good at. And I used it in my college days before I became born again. I used it in my college days. It is tutorial. And when you're a man that knows how to teach tutorial, there are some certain limits you have good access to. Because you always need tutorials. I used that to my family because I knew that somehow I could teach. Other people will teach, but when I teach, they will understand better. And it comes with a lot of advantages. Praise God. But we bless God for being born again. Anyways, so people have different talents. Check that, but that does not mean that is where God has called you to. That is the following God's plan. Some of them are just the natural to you. I've heard people say, I remember one saying, gifts are given to you for what? To serve others. There's a motivational spirit that goes on that says, whatever talent you have, turn it to what? To money. There's a big problem. I see that as a very big problem. Because we find people sitting up and saying, oh, I like to do this. That means I can make money from it. Do we have enough people that their mind has been attuned to that? That whatever I can do, whatever craft I can do well, the next thing I should do is what? Make money from it. So I start thinking of the business side of that talent or of that gift. Praise God. So I realized that I know how to serve people well. I'm sorry, I'm not going to use as an example. I know how to serve people well, so I turn it into catering service and say, because you know I like to cook, I like to give people, so I turn it into my business. I'm not shaming anybody. Praise God. But sometimes this mindset of what we like, what is in need for me, is what kills many other things in the heart of me. Praise God. We have giftings, we have talents. But we must never forget that the primary purpose is for what? For service. And if the primary purpose is for service, I would like to urge you, if your gifting is something that you know it, why don't you try first, turn your attention, turn your primary focus into serving others and see how better it will work. Forget it, they say, ah, we don't like to do they say business progresses when family and friends pay for services. Well, but this was not what Christ had in mind when he was giving each one different gifts. Because it's the same problem we have with people who have the gift of prophesying and asking, should I prophesy? Shall I prophesy? I just read something on the news maybe 2 days ago that there's a particular prophet around town here now. Or it's whether it's in whatever that he prophesies to people, he starts by telling you something that you don't know, and then when he gives you that, all of a sudden people start asking for seed that he will give to a spiritual father. Praise God. And of course, we have students who like to give seed. Please, if you like to give seed, we need money to build those seeds here. Just bring the seed here. Praise God. I mean, don't give to prophets. When we pray for you, as you also have, we are strong. We can pray. Just attend Monday service, Monday prayer meeting. Just bring this here. That giving it to, well, I'm sure nobody here gives you the prophet. See, it does that, and it takes a lot of money. People who make merchandise of the giftings of God. The Bible says, freely you have received, freely give. Is there any gift that you, I don't know how, that was your right? That was your birthright? Hallelujah. You received it from God freely. There are those of you who have the ability to retain things fast, right? There are those who cannot retain things fast. You get what I'm trying to say? There are those who have photographic memory. But it was not as if you went for a training. You got it freely. I'm just giving examples. Even within us in church, there are those who are gifted at leading. There are those who are gifted at following. I'm being realistic.
Exodus chapter 31. Exodus chapter 31. Let's see that. I'm not saying all of you should be followers. No, but Exodus 31. The Bible says, the Lord said to Moses, look, verse 1. I'm starting with verse 1. Look, let's look at two people here. Because I know there are those of you I want to shame and set off. He said, look, I have specially chosen who? Bezalel, son of Uri, the grandson of Hur, the tribe of Judah. I have filled him with the Spirit of God, giving him great wisdom, ability, and what? And expertise in all kinds of crafts. That means this guy was a good craftsman. I'm believing in his case, two things were working: talent and endowment. Because God said, I have filled him with the Spirit. It means if you contract this guy to make chair for you, and you contract this one that went to school of carpentry to make chair for you, you will take his own. Even if it is looking alike, there will be something different. You say, how did you add this finishing to it? Praise God. He says, I have anointed him in all ability, wisdom, and expertise in all kinds of crafts. Look at what he says in verse 4. Although he's anointed him, he says he is a master what? Craftsman. This guy is still somebody who is good at his job. Expert in working with gold. For those of you who say, God gives me as a carpenter, he can. Sisters, if he's a carpenter, he says, don't think because he's a carpenter, nothing can happen. Praise God. They are blessed carpenters. They are blessed mechanics. Praise God. This is the truth. They are blessed mechanics. I know the sister is saying, but that's not for me. Praise God. But that's the truth. There are people blessed in different crafts. And then he says in verse 5, he is skilled in engraving, mounting gemstones, blah, blah, blah. No, don't ever say blah, blah, blah. Praise God. Now in verse 6, I like what he does this. I have personally appointed Oholiab, son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan, to be what? So I said, there are some people who are anointed to lead, and there are those who are graced to follow. Yeah. Praise God. Not everybody will be an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur needs advice. The board of directors needs advice. The manager director needs a deputy. So some of you might be greed that is running you. And what do they call this thing? Forward movement that is doing you. God might have just said, the way we are told is going. I'm sending you, Brother Shile, as an assistant. Praise God. And then all you need to do is serve in that capacity. Wherever he goes, follow. I'm leading him. It's a same God. But one day something will come, come and meet him and say, why must you continue to follow him? Why must you continue to assist him? Can't you start your own? That brother has held your destiny. Mm-hmm. And this usually happens when you have your own partner. I will not follow you if you continue to follow that person. Praise God. People have gifts. So some are anointed to be, some are anointed to follow. You see in this church here as we are today, there are some of you, you already see something that's wrong. Or you already see some things that have been done better. Praise God. Based on what you are gifted or endowed with. Or some people are just endowed with teaching, you've already seen how some things can be taught better. The moment somebody is always about to say something, say, I like how you went there, praise God. But the way the Lord is revealing something to me, he could teach you this way, praise God. Or what if he was this? No, there are people who are not like that. And as you are here, there are somebody thinking, why are they serving wafers and biscuits? We could be bringing God. If you are that one, God is not. If you are that one, I can say confidently that God is speaking to you. Glory to God. No, but that's the truth. And as I sit there, there are some people who have noticed one brother last week and noticed things and said, there's something going on with you. No, it's fine. No. I can tell you there's something going on with you. And then you go out and say, how are you doing, sir? I'm fine. No. I'm not talking about the general, how are you? How are you doing? And then the brother breaks down. And then he's talking. Why? Gifts. And that within the church. But the goal is not to come and scatter the church. Mm-hmm. The goal is to ensure that life is better for what? Everyone. The purpose of gifts and talents is to serve. So in following God's plan, also friends, check the giftings and talents. They are not what you thought they were. Sometimes they are pointers
or they hint you where God is leading you towards. And like he said, sometimes the next thing to do, the right thing to do, is the next step. Perhaps the next step for you is to train yourself in that talent or gift. That might just be the next step. Long time ago, I believe that God does not like mediocre people. I mean, when I say mediocre, he has called you, but he doesn't like you to stay at that level of mediocrity. He expects you to grow. Now, because I've mentioned that talents are for believers and unbelievers, so it means that even if that talent you have, not a lot of believers and believers, you can still see secular people who are operating that talent, and there are one or two things, you know, you don't absorb everything as a believer. But there are one or two things you can still be. Praise God. In the way, imagine, like I said, because everything originates from God. It's just the sad thing that some people who are talented have been perverse by the devil. So rather than using it for the glory of God, the devil has perverse them in a way that they use it to promote the activities of the devil. But it doesn't change about it, there's that talent in there. And usually that's what the devil looks out for. This person has a talent. Before the person goes to use it for God, let me take it. Give you one kind of mega deal like that. $1 million deal, you have left God. You have forgotten in long time. Praise God. You just go out there and then it continues. Before even you start saying, but what is bad with this now? Imagine not saying anything wrong with this one. It's just moral. It's just moral. It's just moral. Next thing, you just say, Pamali, this last year. Hallelujah. Praise God. And that's the end. You have gone. I remember when I used to be here. You know that, you know those two people were so blah blah. I want to pray blah blah. We had that, it was so bad. Segmented. It just went to another direction. Praise God. The devil perverses the things of God. So what I'm trying to say is, even if the talent you haven't found a lot of believers who are going to. There are people in the secular world who are talented. If you are good at playing saxophone, my dear, they are powerful saxophonists, not what you need to do. You know that, right? They will hit notes you have never heard before. You can learn. Doesn't mean that you take their beliefs. Doesn't mean you take their way of life. Because you're a believer, you know how to discern. You know what is evil and what is good. Praise God. So if you're a writer, they are powerful writers. They are powerful writers. I believe, I used to say something. It is only, I think it's now that the church is speaking of, it's only in church you celebrate mediocrity. Usually, mediocrity is celebrated. You can't critique somebody's work because you're telling them. So when you see a friend, she does something, she's not doing it well. Rather than sit up and say, this is not the best you can do. Say, God bless you, ma. Ladies can lie to each other, right? No, ladies know how to lie. God bless you, ma. This is so nice, thank you so much. But when it is time for you to contract somebody to do that same job, you will go and look for an external person. You won't call her. Why? You have lied to her. You are not, listen, you see, that you are doing a business, does not, you don't do business by sentiments. Praise God. You don't do this stuff by sentiments. You get what I'm trying to say? So you'll be begging people to share my team with you. We have eaten your food before. It's not. But you won't tell her. Help her to grow. Learn. So sometimes these giftings and talents are pointers. They might not be what God. It's not necessarily mean that God has called you to be this, but they are pointers and things. When you notice somebody is a pastor, there are some gifts you start seeing manifesting. The pastoral care gifting just comes if the person is called a pastor. As in by God, you see this pastoral care, the anointing to teach is relevant in that office. Why? Because it is necessary for that. But that pastor will not stand there and say, God has called me as a pastor, so I will not study again. He will be a stale pastor. Even though those gifts are available, he needs to what? Learn, grow himself. That's the same as you. You've had gift, I know how to draw. Somebody said, I know there are some pastors who are great teachers and they are also great artists. They can draw. So when they draw, they can even pass a message via the drawing. And then they learn that craft. They learn that skill. Hey, God has called me to do photography. Me, the only the best of the basic rule of thoughts, right? Okay, God has called you, even that basic rule of thoughts, you don't understand. So what is your talent to do? Or what are you doing with your talent? Praise God. So sometimes the next thing for you to do is grow it. personal. Read. People have gone ahead of you. Read.
Learn.
Grow in it. If you have seen an unusual gifting of God in your life, what do you do next? Walk more in it. Listen, if you neglect the gift of God, or the, you know, Paul says, do not neglect the gift of God that is in you, which was said to you by the laying on of hands. So when they anointed you and when they said you are now a pastor, they made you a leader, some gifts were, how would I say, they were stirred inside of you. He said, don't neglect it. Why? If you neglect the gift of God in you, you will never walk in it. It's not that it's not there, but you won't walk in it again. So some of you, the last time, maybe perhaps the last time you heard the word of knowledge was the last time you thought you knew it was there. But now you have even forgotten about it. I remember somebody came to me and said, stop shutting your mouth. When it comes to you, keep saying it. As you keep saying it, you will grow. Even if you make a mistake, you will learn. Then you become a master. So you know when to talk and when not to talk. So do you have talent? Look inward. Write them down if you are as a believer. Please don't be a mediocre believer. Don't be a believer and this and that, and then you just leave your, you are pursuing another man's work. You leave yours there. No. Praise God. Because there's every chance that what God has called you to do, He will use the talent you have. He will use it for His own work.
Good. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm. So your talents are applied to everybody, believers or unbelievers. But giftings or endowment of the Spirit are specifically for believers, for those who are living. And great is the peace and the joy if your talents are in line with the endowment. You see unusual things happen. You see that people are getting good. I know you might have some issues with Donwen and with some of scripturally, what would I say, unsound songs that you must adopt, but you cannot deny that he's a blessed gospel singer. That's for those who know Donwen. I just meant to say that. But he's a blessed gospel singer. I've seen him sing many times. And most times, when you sit down there, you're watching the whole performance, you'll be moved to tears. Or you'll be magnifying the greatness of God. And you see him sing sometimes, you say some people are just healed while he's singing. He's not even preaching. And you know he's gifted in it, but he's also talented. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Because he's not just a singer, he's a music producer. He's not just, he's one who can coordinate. And it's, he has grown his talents. What more is gifted? And now he's using it for the glory of God. This man is over 70 now, and he's still making impact wherever he is and he goes. Praise God. Same thing for us. So I like you, friends. Check in yourself. What are those talents that you think you have that are generally applicable to you? And also, what are those giftings that you have noticed that work for you inside the church? Locate them. Like them now. Begin to work on them. Learn more. Develop yourself. Watch YouTube videos. And if you are a ministry inclined person, listen to ministers. Read the Bible. Study things. The more you do it, you're sharpening up yourself. Mm. And then when you're using these giftings, remember it is for the benefit of people. Not for us. All of God's giftings is to serve another person. Not for you. Praise God. All my meetings is up to me. It was just to bring that to our mindset. So let's rise to our feet.